I'll start off by saying that I'm a bit of an oddball as regards the academic world, because I talk about things that academics don't talk about. But I think by the time I finish, you'll get a general idea of where I think the world should go. There's one thing about getting old is that you don't give two hoots about what other people think. And I think that's one of the great advantages. I mean, there are disadvantages, of course, but that's a distinct advantage. I'd just like you to look at this slide for a minute, starting slide. I've used a word here which is completely banned in science. It's called consciousness. Physicists do not understand anything about consciousness. Okay? There are some guys, call themselves, well, I suppose they call themselves psychologists, and I got one or two friends who are very much anti the sort of stuff I do, but I don't think they understand consciousness either. And I don't think any of us do, really. But we'll have a crack at it. Because today, I want to reveal to you a slightly different approach that we're taking in a crop circle scenario. Now, how do I get into this consciousness field? Well, it's through dowsing. I've been a dowser since my teenage years. And in about the early 1990s, I was one of the team that set up the Earth Energies Group of the British Society of Dowsers, which I'm very pleased to say is still flourishing very well. And also another group, which is slightly more select, and I don't mean select in terms of being elite, I mean just the subject matter, the Dowsing Research Group. Now, it's not full of guys or number crunchers like myself. We have white witches and Buddhist monks among us, okay? So you see, we're a pretty broad church. And I think this has influenced our thinking quite dramatically. So we're going to have a crack at this anyway. It's to make you think about things in a slightly broader fashion than perhaps you've been thinking about. Okay? Those two little images you see, top right-hand corner, top left-hand corner, very important. I just want you to have a look at those and absorb them, because they are key to the way the cosmos is organized. And we find them in things spiritual, ancient sites. We find them in the world of atomic particles. The same geometry. Okay. And the basic shapes that we come across this one here, which you've that others who've suffered me on previous occasions see that that's my favorite shape. And in fact, there's a good theory around about the universe, the cosmos itself, is that shape. I shouldn't use the word shape. I should really use the word topology. That's the topology of the cosmos. Okay? And other things that we're interested in are things like that. Spirals of different sorts. Everything is a spiral. Every energy, everybody talks about energy. We all mean slightly different things. It's all to do with vibration and motion, but it's all got to do with spirals of different forms. Once you know that, it's fairly straightforward. So, we'll now move forward. If we can make this thing work. Last year, I gave a whole series of lectures based on this general theme of bridging the gap between science and spirituality. I first showed this chart, must be well over a year ago now. The chart hasn't changed, but what I say about it has changed completely. Within a year. Two sides, okay? Left-hand side, mainstream science. Right-hand side, the world of spirituality. Now, this guy in this corner here You see, it's got a great big ball with a grid sort of around it, and the crossing over of these lines. Just think about energy lines. I'll just put that into your mind at the moment. That is the mathematical representation of the standard model of particle physics. And when I talked about it last year, I said there's one more bit of the jigsaw puzzle to find, and you would all know what it is because you were listening to your telly 2 weeks ago when you heard all about we have found the Higgs boson. Okay. Now, I suspect 90-odd percent of you have got no idea what the Higgs boson is, but you'd be pleased to know that the majority of the scientists looking for it don't either. But where these things cross over, these energy lines, okay, or in that particular model of it, is where we have these particles, so-called particles. And it's really just a mathematical representation. That's called a group. And it's the most complicated mathematical group that's, say, a mixture of things ever invented, okay? It's taken well over 100 years to solve that particular mathematical problem. But all I want you to notice, they call it E8 by E8. Relevant the title, apart from the number 8. And we shall say quite a bit about that. But you begin to see this shape here. There's light being shone through that open globe to create this pattern on the ground. Now, the key thing I'm going to say about this is that that ball is in three dimensions. The pattern on the ground is in two dimensions. And the thing about crop circles, we all talk about two dimensions. Not so. It's compressing three dimensions into two dimensions. And I make no excuses for probably going to repeat that 20 times, okay? That is the crucial thing. Nobody said it so far today. But I want you all to remember that because that's the crucial thing. When we look at that pattern, which is a projection, a two-dimensional projection of the standard model and all the particles, and then you analyze that from a mathematical point of view, it's got all the numbers we find in crop circles in that two-dimensional projection. That, from a mathematical point of view, is a crop circle. And the atomic physicist ain't got a clue. That's that side of things. Let's come to this side. Well, where do you start when you're talking about spirituality? You can go back X thousand years. That's absolutely fine. But I'll only go back to the beginning of the 19th century, whereby there was a team called of Leadbetter and Besson. Those who you are familiar with theosophy will be familiar with this, that Leadbetter used his mind as a microscope. A mind microscope. And he said to himself, what does the smallest particle Mother Nature produce? What does it look like? And this is the shape he came up with. Okay. And that was the basis of a whole tome of work called occult chemistry. And I'm going to say a bit more about that, because that is the key. That, and that is the key to crop circles. How do we join these things together? Well, this is my bridge. A year ago, we were on a rather rickety rope bridge, I thought. I thought we'd seen the light. We'd got some idea about what one group was saying and what the other group was saying. And I felt that the way ahead would end up with something like the Sydney Harbour Bridge. Good, solid British engineering. we ain't there yet. We're somewhere hovering in the middle. We've moved on from the shaky rope bridge we were on a year or so ago. Now, I've just got a little symbol here, which I'm not going to dwell on, but people have mentioned it already. It is standing waves, how you link something over there to something over here. And you all know how a rope works. The two people at the end work together as a team, and whatever you put in at one end comes out at the other end. And there's lots of musicians here, no doubt. Got your pianos at home. Pianos, violins, all those instruments, standing waves. The universe is music. That's all we'll say. Well, I thought I'd start off with some crop circles, because I'm talking now about links to the Wiltshire group. I was asked, I can't even remember the year now, to come and talk to them about what I thought would happen, what the state of play was in about 94 or 5. And I said, well, I've just been doing some sums, and I think that crop circles are really based on this sort of topology I've talked to you about, with waves wound around it. Okay? And so you can't probably see that terribly clearly, because that was done on a Microsoft 97 program with a 50 megabyte, I said megabyte, disk, hard disk. So things were somewhat limited then. But at least that was a shape. And I talked at Coronation Hall, and one of the questions I got when I'd finished was, and what would you like to see in the fields this year? And I said, well, I'd love to see something like that, because just to show that I've got my sums right. But 3 weeks later, I got a telephone call one Friday evening. Francine here, it's arrived for you. And that was a telephone call. And that is it. And we've seen it already today. I'm very pleased that Gunter had analysed this. And I'm not going to talk about number 33, because that's all part of it. But that really is a two-dimensional representation of waves around one of these things. Three dimensions squashed into two dimensions. Okay, that was one thing that turned up. This is an interesting one. Lucy showed this already. I remember I was asked to come and talk at the Wiltshire Weekend Conference. And it got to, I think it was Wednesday evening, and Francine rang and said, we haven't got a crop circle yet. I said, oh, don't worry. And I happened to be in Bristol that day, talking to my university colleagues down there. And as I drove back again, and I drove back over the hill, you know where it is, don't you? Over the top of the hill there, and on the other side, Alton Priors, this beautiful crop circle. So I said to Lucy, that's a Taurus knot, and it's stuck ever since. And there's a sequel to that, because I was just going through some of the literature that had been published by the Institute of Physics at St. Petersburg University about the effects of the sun on the Earth, and they had a picture of this crop circle in their academic report. I think Lucy keeled over when I told her that. So there we are. That's a nice follow-up to it, wasn't it? Because I do remember a wonderful meditation we had in that crop circle. And one other thing. I think a year later, or maybe 2 years later, it got to the Saturday, and again, things were not very lively in the field. And I gave my presentation, and I'd been working with Michael Glickman through the year, saying, it's time we got to a crop circle that had the number 9 in it. Isn't it, Michael? And he said, you're absolutely right, Jim. Nothing had turned up. And then on the Sunday morning, the crop circle connector boys came up to us and said, something occurred overnight. Okay? And we'd been, the day before, on the top of the White Horse there, just above the White Horse at Chair Hill, with one of my dowsing colleagues. And I looked at my dowsing colleague, and I said to him, you're thinking the same thing that I'm thinking, aren't you? Isn't that a wonderful spot for a crop circle? Cut a long story short, that turned up exactly where we said it should be, with exactly the things we were playing around with. When things like that happen to you, you begin to think that somehow or other, 3 pounds of grey matter is somehow bolted into this process. But how? This is really quite a challenge. Let's see if we can move this thing on. Struggling with this. That's one. That's it. Bit of ancient stuff. The ancient Greeks were very much into this thing called Ouroboros, which means literally in ancient Greek, tail eating. And they always represented it as a snake biting its own tail. Okay. And you all know about the caduceus, BMA, symbol, ain't very ancient science, two intersecting snails, snakes, I should say. Okay. So that's the caduceus. And then just to bring it thoroughly up to date, a picture of this guy here with his, and I've seen it in my local town, and I'm sure lots of you have seen them with this torch, but they don't realize it represents a conical spiral going up. That's what it is fundamentally. Okay. So you can begin to see there's an awful lot of history associated with all of this sort of stuff. This is really nice stuff, isn't it? Because those of you who are into healing know that these creatures are absolutely wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. And I did some work just about 2 or 3 years ago with dolphins in the Caribbean, measuring their energy fields. And it's unbelievable. You may have a typical energy field of 3 or 4 meters. That had tens of meters. Okay. And it's the interaction with people. But what I particularly want to concentrate on is the fun they have, because they blow these things in water, which are called bubble rings. And if you just YouTube dolphins bubble rings, you'll be there all night, going, whoa. It's absolutely magic. They blow them, they usually work in pairs, and one of them blows a small one, and then as it slows down, it grows bigger. That's just simple physics, okay? So it gets to the size of a hula hoop, and the one behind goes over the first dolphin, goes through the middle. It comes round, it blows another one, and the second one comes round, and they go around in circles, blowing these bubble rings, diving through them. Magic, absolutely magic. You'll be totally mesmerized just watching YouTube doing that. Now then, so what we're talking about is one of these things I've been talking about here, which can spin both that way and around the toroid as well. Okay, that's what makes it expand and do this sort of thing. So bubble rings are absolutely key to what these guys are doing, but when you apply it to atomic physics, the mainstream guys at the moment say particles, atomic particles, are made of some substance in nothing. These guys say it ain't like that at all. That is water in water. But it's water in a different state, different format. And this is the way one can interpret atomic physics, in that we are living in something akin to a fluid. Forget the air for a moment. I'm thinking beyond the air, in some sort of fluid that works just like these guys blow bubbles. And it is the spinning up of the universal field of fluid which creates the particles. Particles, whatever they are no more than spun up space. So everything is the same. Okay? Makes so much sense. It's absolutely straightforward common sense. Unless you're an atomic physicist. And I've mentioned the number 8. And I just throw up a few things here for you. The Eightfold Way, that's a Buddhist expression, okay? As you're probably well aware. But, well, it's got the thing in the center, chess. 8x8, in terms of players there. Piano keyboard. Let's talk about that, because that's very, very, very important. C to upper C, okay? Eight notes, the diatonic scale. And we'll talk about the diatonic scale in some detail. When it comes to living matter, DNA double helix. Okay. We discovered all that in about 1953. And then when we worked out the structure of DNA, which took a long, long time, they went back and suddenly discovered the Chinese had invented the I Ching in 3000 BC, and it's precisely the same code. They were 3,000 years, 5,000 years behind the time. All the same stuff. So there you are, the number 8 appearing. Now, I'm not going to dwell on this, but this is the smallest bits of atomic physics that we know about. These things called quarks. You've probably heard of quarks. And 2 to the power 3 is 8, okay? 2 times 2 times 2, so on. And those are very much part of the structure of atomic physics as well. The number 8 is absolutely everywhere. So we'll need that. It's already gone past something there. Oh, yes. We talked about vibration of things. And what I want to talk to you about, we've had these wonderful gongs, meditation gongs, sound, vibration, the cosmic drum. This great big field of energy is vibrating all the time. And it's very much like a timpani drum. And in fact, the way the ancient Chinese used to tune their gongs was to sprinkle sand on it and then tap it at different places. And where the sand built up, they could then tell what the fundamental notes were. And here you are on a timpani drum, depending on where you hit it, with sprinkling sand on a timpani drum, you get these different shapes. You begin to get the idea of how you build up a crop circle. It's the fundamental vibration of the earth. Okay. And you start to get these shapes here. If you go to quite complex patterns, and this is called cymatics in this day and age, you can get remarkable vibration patterns. These are, again, effectively sound on some vibrating membrane. They're very crop circle-ish, aren't they? Remarkably so. All the numbers we're talking about, it's all vibration. And the fundamental underlying pattern is what we call this spider's web pattern, which has got 6 rings and 8 radials. 8x6. And when we come to counting all the crossover points and linking it all with atomic physics, we haven't got time to do that today, all the same stuff. So we're talking about crop circles being vibrations, vibrational patterns on the earth. And then when we couple it up with energy lines, okay, energy lines are again just vibrations on the earth's surface. And generally speaking, they go north, south, east, west. When people talk, I hate the word ley lines. Forget the word ley lines. Ley just means meadow, just means lines across the meadow. These are real structured energy lines. And in fact, I've already found a crossover of energy lines in here just to prove the point. There's a set here, okay? And there are two sets of lines. There's one spiral going one way and another going the other. And we come along here, and there's another one. Very convenient spot this is. It's usually in the corner like that when I give a lecture. And it's there here. And there's the center point there. And there's the first ring there. Okay, and there's another ring round here. It's that pattern. It's that pattern I showed you. Okay. And that is how we build up these sorts of basically circular patterns. And Mother Nature gives us all that for free. Okay? And it's our interaction with this vibrating surface that generates these wonderful patterns. So there's a crop circle really mimicking the sort of thing that I'm talking about. Now then, applying all this lot to ancient sites, I knew people would talk about Stonehenge and Avebury, so I've chosen something completely different. And I'm talking to you about Knowlton Henge. Maybe some of you know Knowlton Henge, it's near Salisbury. And it's a rather spooky place, but we won't go into that today. It's not relevant to our thinking. What is relevant, though, is the fact that this thing with a ditch is really one of these sliced in the middle, and you've got the bottom bit there. Our forefathers dug the ditch not to keep the cattle in, as some of our scientific friends say. It's actually to control the energy, because the energy then spirals all the way around. But the interesting thing about Knowlton Henge is that we have energy lines going through it, but they are standing wave patterns I've just mentioned to you. And two of my Dowsing Research Group colleagues, Hugh Desai and David Webb, just about 2 years ago, for the first time, we discovered the electric charge concentrations at these nodal points in Knowlton Henge. We've been trying for 20 years to do it. And this was really quite a step forward. We've only just now got the equipment to tap in to this universal energy field of consciousness. It's just coming. So that's a significant part of it. And you'd be interested to know that the shape of Knowlton Henge is just one of these things here. It's just a ring here. If I can find the right one. It's one where the hole is the same width as the thickness of the toroid itself. There's one winding around it, collapsed into two dimensions, as I told you, and that gives you a beautiful shape on the ground. And that's exactly, we know mathematically, the exact shape of that henge. And that was, and the mathematics for that was only discovered in the 18th century. Our forefathers were finding and creating these henges with that exact mathematical pattern then. Now then, have I got the right thing again? Yes, I have. This is interesting, isn't it? That person behind that stone is me. This is a single standing stone down in Devon. I was asked to go and investigate it because it was rather lonely by the river there, doing nothing in particular. People asked me to say, what was it doing there? Well, the interesting thing is about this is that when my wife took that photograph and we took it home, we could see this subtle energy coming from the stones, this column of energy. Okay. And you can see the underlying geometry that I put around the whole stone. And here all we've done is change the contrast, and you can see really a globe. It's a hemisphere above that stone. And all standing stones, all hinges, they are crop circles, are all in bubbles, bubbles of energy. Three dimensions. It's a total sphere, half above the ground, half below the ground. And the walls are not this soapy material that you blow bubbles with when you're a kid. It's electric charge, like a wall of electric charge. It's called a double layer. Langmuir double layer is the technical term for this. But we won't go into that. But everything is three dimensions. Those of you who got a spiritual background and know about Walter Russell, he sort of got plugged into the universe for about 2 months. And when he came back, he drew all the things that he saw. And he's been drawing all the fundamental shapes that we've been finding in crop circles. It was only about 3 or 4 years ago that I went through his work and said, what did he discover? What have we discovered? Snap. It was that sort of process. And this is the sort of process that we get with galaxies in space, with jets coming out of the spheres surrounding galaxies. It's all the same sort of stuff. When we start to look a little bit at the technicalities of this, there's the total globe I'm talking about, there's a central sphere, and there is a toroid. Think of it in three dimensions like that. And you can see the sort of shapes of these vortices coming up, these conical shapes. And what we find is that you can go 3, 5, 7, 9, and these conical vortices are getting narrower and narrower. That is the basic shape of any crop circle. And you're pleased to know you can put the same shape we find for a crop circle bang on Saturn. Fits Saturn beautifully. There it is, there's the bottom end of Saturn, which has been well photographed this whole area for the last few years, and it's part of this conical vortex coming through the toroid. And one additional thing is, I first talked about it about 93, the rings of Saturn are its crop circles. Clearly not in a way that we understand it, but in terms of the physics of it, dead the same. So there we are. There's a link between planetary stuff and other stuff that we're familiar with. How do crop circles get formed? Well, it's really electrical discharge to underground water. Water trapped well below ground. When electric current flows through it, you get a remarkable discharge which blows these vortex rings up through the surface, and you get these sorts of shapes on the surface. That one there was just last year in Yorkshire. When a lady wanted to set up a new group, she said, wouldn't it be nice to have a crop circle? So the next day or two, that appeared for her, you see. And there you are at the top right-hand corner. When whales blow through their spout, They create things that look just like crop circles. So the stuff we're talking about is known in different parts of science. Very well known already. Well, I talked to you about rings. When this shape occurred in about 1989, people said, oh, it can't be the wind blowing down on the grass, something like that. What actually happens? Well, let's go back to this shape here. Everything's in a sphere. The sphere, just as you put soap bubbles together, you know, you get these dividing walls between the bubbles, don't you? And that's what happens here. And you get conical vortices in the center, and you get four different sections. Four different sections. And the air can flow each of these different directions. So that's the way in which crop circles are formed. And when you get complicated crop circles, it's just like embroidery. Just like embroidery, going through a ring here, but it's not clearly not thread, it's a vortex thread, which comes up and over, and it's only when it comes through the surface does it create these sorts of shapes. And this is the vortex filament that creates it. That is the way, in fact, you can create these patterns. The universe operates according to electricity, not electromagnetics per se. Crop circles are not electromagnetics necessarily, they are electric charge. And that is the way the universe operates as well. And it's these two guys, Christian Birkeland in the beginning of the last century, who did all the work on the Aurora Borealis, understood the fundamentals of all this, and this work here, this guy on the right-hand side, Hannes Alfen, Swedish guy, showed how all these vortex filaments wound around one another in this sort of filamental form. And so that is really the basics of the whole process. We've talked about this already today, but when I saw that crop circle, I first thought of this, the base clef. It's a base clef. But the energy from this crop circle is by far the greatest I've ever measured. The energy from seeds from the center there is absolutely staggering in comparison with the majority of them. How does it form? Well, it is in fact effectively one of these things laid out on the ground and moving around like this in this shape. But I showed you the first picture where you can have strings. I think we've moved on to something else, haven't we? Strings around strings. And let's see if we can find this. There it is there, look. There's the basic shape. Well, you've got toroids around toroids around toroids. And these things get laid out and you get things wrapping around here and wrapping around here. This sort of shape. And in fact, we can predict quite accurately, mathematically, the shape of that Julia set. And it's not unlike the shell, the Nautilus shell that you're quite used to. So that is the way, in principle, we can create these complicated crop circle patterns. I talked to you about music. There's a piano keyboard. It's all to do with these harmonics. And going from C to A, for example, that gives us our golden ratio, 1.62 ratio, round figures. And the piano keyboard, this is the Fibonacci series, which shows you how the piano keyboard is designed according to Fibonacci rules. And perhaps one of the most important things that came out of this work was that a fundamental number of quantum physics called the fine structure constant, we needn't really go into it, is all to do with the piano keyboard. The key number of quantum physics is buried in crop circles. That's the message I wanted to get across to you. So again, a very strong link between science and spirituality and musicality. Now, when we douse objects, we douse a whole set of rings around some central object here. Okay, and there's a central object. If that's a pepper pot on your kitchen table, you can douse a whole set of rings around it. And the ratio of that distance to that distance to that distance comes up with this fundamental number, 0.89, or round about 89. And that is absolutely key to the way crop circles are organized. Dousing a pepper pot on the kitchen table gives you this thing that looks like a discus in three dimensions, which is in fact the shape of the Milky Way. So consciousness is linked in to the organization of the cosmos. Consciousness concepts. It was Descartes who said that your mind and matter are completely separate, and science has gone entirely along the lines of matter. Forget that bit. But his contemporary, Spinoza, thought otherwise. And it's called panpsychism, where you get some overlapping of consciousness into everyday objects. So according to Spinoza, something like a stone, for example, would be conscious, but only slightly so. And it's this sort of approach which I've been adopting for quite some time. We've already heard about chaos today, order to chaos. And this really emerged as a concept from a mathematical point of view about only 30 years or so ago. But what I've been doing, and my colleagues have been doing, is looking at applying these ideas from chaos theory to how your mind works. I don't know what you're like, but on an everyday basis, where I think about this and I think about something else, and everybody thinks about it in a slightly chaotic sort of fashion. And it's only when you meditate do you go back from chaos to order. And we've been applying these ideas of chaos theory to the mind. And this is the sort of process that happens in the brain. And when we meditate, everything happens in terms of the frequencies in the brain. They all settle down nicely. But when the normal situations, there's quite a lot of activity in the higher frequencies. And this is what Lucy was talking about this morning. And that is the way in which the process of going from order to chaos really occurs. And now we can talk about us in terms of the chakra systems now. We're talking about the ancient ideas of the energy field, and I mentioned to you about Leadbeater and Besson and the size of the universal atom and how it really totally embraces the human body. And then these are key energy centers, conical energy centers from chakras which are just like crop circles. In terms of the structure of these energy centers, this is just like a crop circle on its side, for example. And so your body is built just the same way as the universe is built, and indeed, the crop circles are built on a similar pattern. And then we started to look at, can we create these energy lines on the ground? Can we do it mentally? They do exist naturally, but can we create them? And my colleague, Jeffrey Keane, said, I'll have a crack at see if I can create these energy lines. And the only bit of information he gave me was, we can create three lines and it's got spirals at the end. And when he did it, the spirals he got were just like the ones that Lucy was showing you this morning. And he got conical spirals emerging at the end. When I looked at it, I got slightly different results, but I got spirals going the other way. And in three dimensions, this is what we get. It looks just like the coaxial cable that you have in your television set from a topological point of view. It's really quite intriguing. So these psi lines you can create mentally quite easily. I don't think we'll go into that. What we are doing is creating psi lines or psi tubes around our head to some distant object. And we can create them on the ground, or we can create them in space. And when we imagine it, we begin to see how this ties in with the ancient science, because it's all got to do with the third eye. We've heard the pineal gland mentioned today, haven't we? And it's the third eye which is the source of your psychic capability. And it's as if you have a tube of energy going from your head to wherever you want to direct it. And this is the process that's involved in crop circle creation. So this is your head here, with the end of this tube of energy going to wherever you want to direct it. And this ties in with all the ancient ideas, for example, of certainly in Hindu culture, the third eye and the bindi mark there. And obviously the halos around ancient pictures, drawings. This is a representation of this end of the energy line. And it's all linked to your third eye chakras. These chakras go forward and indeed backwards. And when Rupert Sheldrake was doing his work on the sense of being stared at, lots of you are very familiar, I'm sure, with Rupert Sheldrake. And he did lots of tests whereby people could sense other people looking at you from behind. And what we did was we repeated these sorts of experiments using this, creating these psi lines or psi tubes. And I did an experiment at home with a rather naughty cat of mine that, following a demeanor of his, was shooting for the cat flap. And I fired one of these psi tubes at him, and it came to an absolute grinding halt. It's as if he could sense me telling him to come to a grinding halt. And this is what we're really talking about now. We're linking all the stuff to do with energy lines, natural energy lines, and created energy lines with this whole idea of these psi lines or psi tubes and the ancient science. So it's now forming a pretty consistent pattern, I think, now, in terms of what we are doing.